We come to the second Advent Sunday and the start of our series of studies in the book of Matthew. And we start now with Matthew chapter 1. Last week we had a look at Malachi because I felt that it was important for us to look at the last passage of the Old Testament before we looked at the first passage of the New Testament, which is Matthew chapter 1 verses 1 through 17. So, as usual, we're going to just read through this passage, and then I forgot to bold the words to verse 17. So, when we come to verse 17, if I could ask all of us to read together with me the words of verse 17. So, right now, Matthew chapter 1, verses 1 through 17. This is the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, Judah the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar, Perez the father of Hezron, Hezron the father of Ram, Ram the father of Aminadab, Aminadab the father of Nashon, Nashon the father of Salmon, Salmon the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab, Boaz the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth, Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of King David. David was the father of Solomon, whose mother had been Uriah's wife. Solomon, the father of Rehoboam, Rehoboam, the father of Abijah, Abijah, the father of Asa, Asa, the father of Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat, the father of Jehoram, Jehoram, the father of Uzziah, Uzziah, the father of Jotham, Jotham, the father of Ahaz, Ahaz, the father of Hezekiah, Hezekiah, the father of Manasseh, Manasseh, the father of Amon, Amon, the father of Josiah, and Josiah, the father of Jeconiah, and his brothers at the time of the exile to Babylon. After the exile to Babylon, Jeconiah, the father of Shealtiel, Shealtiel, the father of Zerubbabel, Zerubbabel, the father of Abihud, Abihud, the father of Eliakim, Eliakim, the father of Azor, Azor, the father of Zadok, Zadok, the father of Akim, Akim, the father of Elihud, Elihud, the father of Eleazar, Eleazar, the father of Matan, Matan, the father of Jacob, and Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary. And Mary was the mother of Jesus, who is called the Messiah. Read together. Thus, there were 14 generations in all from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the exile in Babylon, and 14 from the exile to the Messiah. This is the word of the Lord. Father, we all want to confess, Lord, that when we start reading the book of Matthew and we look at this list, sometimes we start to wonder why this list, and sometimes the names are quite meaningless to us. And we want to confess that sometimes when we read scripture, and it's not this passage, other passages of scripture too, sometimes it looks mundane to us. And we want to say before you this morning that reading scriptures is a spiritual experience. And the words will remain words in the Bible itself unless the Holy Spirit anoints our hearts to understand these words afresh. So we pray that you will help us understand these words afresh, that you anoint these words that we have just read and anoint the words that I have prepared, and that we would receive these words from you, just as we receive the baby Jesus from you every Christmas. Let not I be seen, but Christ be seen in me. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. New Year resolutions was always a major part of my life when I was growing up in Malaysia. And there was a very frequent resolution that I would have in my teenage years. I would start the year by saying to myself, I will read the Bible this year and I will read from Genesis to Revelation. But I will start with the New Testament. Because when you read Deuteronomy and Leviticus in the Old Testament, you get sidetracked by the list and the laws in it. So I still recall every year, January the 1st, or if I remember January the 2nd, or if I remember January the 3rd, I'll proceed to read Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. And I'll carry on reading until I reach verse 10, and then I get tired of reading because I get tired of reading whoever was the father of whoever. And then I want to confess to you, I will close the Bible on January the 2nd, 1976, and say to myself, perhaps I will not do this resolution this year, and shelve the resolution for the forthcoming year of 1977. So it's very difficult, isn't it, when we start the New Testament and we read this passage, it's just a list of names. And we ask ourselves, what's the point? Why does Matthew begin this gospel with this list? This is the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. These are the first words of the New Testament. And these words in itself tell you that somehow there is some kind of continuation from the Old Testament, because Jesus the Messiah is now introduced as the son of David and the son of Abraham. So when you think of David and when you think of Abraham, that accounts for at least half the Old Testament. And then as you read this particular passage, you find that the word exile is mentioned. And this is the time when King Nebuchadnezzar overran Jerusalem in 586 BC and flattened the temple and took a lot of the people of Israel to Babylon. And that's where the book of Daniel and other prophets of the Bible continue on the story. And so when you have the mention of David, Abraham, and the exile in this first list of names, that in itself is the summary of the Old Testament. And so, therefore, if you like, Matthew is trying to say here, the Old Testament has finished, and the New Testament has begun. And this is the list of the names of people whose stories are contained in the Old Testament beforehand. And so therefore, these names have meaning. And when you read some of these names, like when you read Judah and Jacob, and when you read David and Abraham, and when you read Hezekiah or some of these kings, these names account for maybe 10, 20 chapters in the Old Testament perhaps, but some of these names just have one paragraph mention. So therefore, as we start the reading of Matthew, there's this sense, because of the listing of the names of the people in the Old Testament, that the whole of the Old Testament is now pointing to this particular point of history, and that the Old Testament has ended, and that now the New Testament has begun. And if you look at the list of names in a bit more detail and you try to remember some of the stories about these people in the Old Testament, you will find that, and remember, okay, this in this particular passage in Matthew, it says at the start, this is the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the King, the anointed Savior who is to come. And then in verse 16, it says, the mother of Jesus, Mary, who was the mother of Jesus, who is called the Messiah, the King. Okay? So therefore, Matthew is trying to tell us that the King has arrived. And when you read stories about kings and queens, you start to, you know, in our storybook account of life, in our Hollywood inspired visions of life, you tend to wonder if these kings and here had, if you like, a rosy life. Okay, but then when you read at the Old Testament, and in a moment we're going to just look at a few names here, you will find that there are some questionable scandals related to some of these names. And so therefore, some of these names carry a story that's not pleasant. And we're going to examine some of these names this morning because we want to let you know that at the end of the day, it is a story of human struggle within the family of Israel that remains disobedient before the Lord, and hence, God has to recalibrate, if you like, and come into this world in the man, the Lord Jesus Christ. For a start, if you look at the list of the kings after David, you will find that there are some, and in Sunday school, you used to learn about good kings and bad kings of Judah and Israel. And there are some bad kings that are mentioned in the list: Rehoboam, Abijah, Jehoram, Ahaz, Manasseh, and Amon. They are all bad kings. And they are bad kings because they gave in to the idols of the land, and they were they jeopardized the spiritual life of Israel. They made Israel worship idols rather than Yahweh, God. And this is what Jeremiah says about Jeconiah, who is also known as Jehoiakim. And if you look at his name here, his name is recorded in verse 11 and 12. Jeconiah, another name for him is Jehoiakim. Is this man Jehoiakim a despised broken pot, an object no one wants? Why will he and his children be hurled out, cast into a land they do not know? O land, 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 hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Lord says. Record this man as if childless, a man who will not prosper in his lifetime, for none of his offspring will prosper, none will sit on the throne of David or rule anymore in Judah. And Jeconiah or Jehoiakim here is known as a very bad king, a cruel king. So much so that God, Jeremiah, curses Jeconiah here and says that there will be no offspring on his throne when he is exiled into Babylon. So again, there are bad kings recorded here. And another observation of this list: for most of us who live in the 21st century, you will see that this is a male-based genealogy. Okay, Matthew does mention five women: Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, the wife of Uriah, and Mary, the mother of Jesus. So it tends to show us that when Matthew lists this list, he lived in a male-oriented society, and he carried on what was the culture of the day in first century Israel. So we have this, the names of these five women mentioned here, and I want to just unpack why these five women are mentioned. Why does Matthew mention these specific names? And we start with the name Tamar. To understand Tamar, we need to understand Judah. Judah is the fourth son of Jacob, the son of Isaac, the son of Abraham. In Genesis 38, Judah is a spoiled brat. Basically, he's a spoiled brat. He causes heartache to his parents. He leaves his family and goes on to live with the pagan Canaanites. And he marries a Canaanite woman by the name of Shua and has three sons with her: Onan and Shelah. And then he arranges a Canaanite woman named Tamar to marry his firstborn son, Ur. Ur is a wicked person. He dies. And then Onan, as in the custom of marriages in Israel of the day, being the second son, he marries Tamar, but Onan himself is a wicked person and he dies. And so in the tradition of the day, the third son now can marry Tamar, but Shelah, the third son, is only a boy. She has to wait before she can marry Shelah. Tamar refuses to wait. And this is the controversial part of the story here. She dresses up as a shrine prostitute and seduces Judah, her father-in-law. She wears a veil so that her father-in-law doesn't know that it's Judah. And Judah is seduced by her and wants to sleep with her. And before he enters into a contract to sleep with Tamar. But before he does it, she asks for his seal, cord, and staff as a pledge. And so she receives the seal, the cord of the staff of Judah. And then after this one night stand, if you like, Tamar is found pregnant. And she is accused of prostitution. She is about to be burnt. Then she produces Judah's seal, cord, and staff to show that she has been made pregnant by Judah. And Tamar is spared of the burning. And so Judah then utters these words as she is spared about her actions. Judah recognized them, that is the seal, the cord, and the staff, and said, "She is more righteous than I, since I wouldn't give her to my son Shelah," and he did not sleep with her again. It's very strange. Judah seems to imply that Tamar is righteous because by seducing Judah as a temple prostitute, she produced sons for the family. And so all my life as I read this, I've always wondered, why did Judah pronounce Tamar as righteous? After all, she did pose to be a shrine prostitute. Why did she do that? And then around 10 years ago, as I was reading and going through commentary, there was this Bible scholar who said, and it made sense then, you have to remember that Judah left his family and looked for a wife with the Canaanite women. So he left behind his faith. But Tamar, she didn't want to wait for Shelah, but she wanted to produce, if you like, some heir for the family. And so in her very controversial way, she actually produced an heir for Judah to carry on, if you like, the spiritual seed of the family. And so therefore, it is then explained why Judah considers Tamar righteous, because Tamar does not go out of the family to produce heir, unlike Judah. Judah went out of the family to produce heir, and Tamar keeps herself within the family. Now, it's a scandal. To do this, she posed as a shrine prostitute. And so that's why in Matthew 1 and 3, it says this: Judah, the father of Perez and Zerah, who were the two sons produced because of this one-night stand, whose mother was Tamar. Tamar is actually mentioned in the genealogy of Jesus for doing this, a scandal in the ancestral cupboard of Jesus, the Messiah. Now, not only does Tamar pose as a shrine prostitute, Rahab is a prostitute in Jericho. She makes her living by sleeping with other men. And in Joshua chapter 2, we read the story of how Rahab the prostitute shielded these two spies from the people of Israel and helped them escape. And in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 31, this prostitute, Rahab, is considered righteous because her act of shielding these two spies says that she acted in faith. By faith, the prostitute Rahab, because she welcomed the spies, was not killed with those who were disobedient. And because of this, Rahab becomes a hero of faith in Hebrews chapter 11. Now, it's important to note that Rahab is not the birth mother of Boaz, because in Matthew chapter 1, verse 5, you will read, "Salmon, the father of Boaz, whose mother is Rahab." Boaz will marry Ruth and become the great-grandfather of King David. And the story of Boaz and Ruth happened in 1200 BC. Rahab the prostitute in the Jericho invasion lived during 1400 BC. And so when it says that Rahab is the mother of Boaz, it actually means that Rahab is the ancestral mother of Boaz and not the real mother of Boaz. I need to explain here because if you read the stories in Genesis, in Ruth and also in Genesis, you find that there's a lapse in time between Rahab and Boaz and Ruth. So we come now to Ruth, who is the Moabite daughter-in-law of Naomi. And in Matthew 1 verse 5, it says, Boaz, the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Mother was Ruth. And so we know the story of Ruth and Naomi. Naomi and her husband and two sons go to Moab to find a new life for themselves because Israel is in a famine. And then the two sons die. Her husband dies. The two sons die. And Ruth volunteers to return with Naomi to the land, and she gleans the barley fields to collect food for them because they are very poor. And then Naomi advises Boaz to woo Boaz because Boaz is a distant relative of the family and can marry this widow so that he can redeem the family and provide for the family. And so we have this story of Boaz eventually marrying Ruth. And in an amazing tribute to Naomi, this is how the elders of the village praise the actions of Ruth, the foreigner Moabite, in marrying Boaz. Through the offspring of the Lord, Ruth 4 verse 12, through the offspring of the Lord, through the offspring the Lord gives you by this woman, Ruth, may your family be like that of Perez, the son of Tamar, born to Judah. Okay, so there's this connection here in the genealogy of Matthew chapter 1. And then later on, this is how the book of Ruth ends. Ruth 4, 18 to 22. This then is the family line of Perez. Remember, Perez is the son of the liaison between Judah and Tamar. Perez was the father of Hezron, the father of Ram, the father of Amminadab, the father of Nashon, the father of Salmon, the father of Boaz. And Matthew adds this phrase, whose mother or whose ancestral mother was Rahab. And then Boaz, the father of Obed, the father of Jesse, the father of David. Matthew actually lives this whole last part of Ruth and puts it into his genealogy. Now, Tamar poses as a shrine prostitute. Rahab is a prostitute herself. Ruth is a foreigner who worshipped idols before she came to Israel. And now we come to Uriah's wife. And Matthew 1 verse 6, David was the father of Solomon, whose mother had been Uriah's wife. And as Matthew writes this account, he's so taken aback by the scandal of David committing adultery with Bathsheba that he can't even mention the name of Bathsheba. And so therefore, and you know how David lapsed into this sin, if you like, the sin of adultery. In spring, all the time when kings go off to war, David sent Joab and with the king's men and the whole Israelite army, they destroyed the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah, but David remained in Jerusalem. David let his guard down. He should have been in the battlefield with his men. Instead, he decides to take time off work. Idle hands are the devil's workshop. And so after watching Bathsheba bathe from his balcony, he proceeds to ask for her, and he has a one-night stand, if you like, with Bathsheba. She becomes pregnant. He tries to cover up his tracks. He tries to ask Uriah to come home from the battlefront and tries to tell him to go home so that at least he went home so that if the baby is born, it'll be viewed by people around him, them, as the baby of the liaison between Uriah and Bathsheba. Uriah refuses to go home because he feels sympathy with his men. How can he go home when his men are in a battlefield? And David, King David, Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham, David of all people, to cover his tracks, what does he do? He commits murder. He gets rid of Uriah. He asks Joab to send Uriah up into the front, and Uriah is killed. And then he proceeds to marry Bathsheba. David not only commits adultery, he also commits murder. He kills Bathsheba's husband. And so therefore, when you look at this list here, all is not rosy, is it? For a start, these four women we've mentioned, they are not purebred Jews. Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, and Bathsheba, they are all Canaanites. They do not come from the Jewish family itself. And yet, they are mentioned in this genealogy of Matthew chapter 1. And so, I believe that Matthew is making a point here. This is the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. And he's trying to say, the Messiah is born despite these skeletons in the cupboard. God is slowly and surely through history working his purposes to bring about salvation and hope. God overturns the scandal of Tamar's seduction to bring about righteousness. God directs the two spies to the house of Rahab the prostitute. She saves them from the Jericho police. God overturns the scandal of Rahab's profession. God overturns the loss of Naomi's husband and two sons in Moab. Ruth is the Moabite who will become the great-grandmother of David. Despite adultery and murder, Bathsheba brings into the world Solomon, the heir to the Davidic throne. Despite Jeremiah's cursing of Jehoiakim from having a royal heir, he reappears as Jeconiah in the genealogy of Matthew. Now, this story should not be an excuse for us to indulge in sin. Judah acknowledges that Tamar posed as a prostitute. Rahab is referred to as a prostitute in Hebrew and James. Ruth is a pagan Moabite who worshipped idols before she came to Israel. David's adultery and murder is condemned by the prophet Nathan. Jeremiah acknowledges that Jehoiakim is cruel. It should not be an excuse for us to indulge in sin, but it should remind us that there, for the grace of God, go I, my friend. That Matthew is trying to tell us that there are scandals in the genealogy of the Lord Jesus Christ, but our God overturns the scandals to bring about salvation. The first coming of Jesus the Messiah overturns the scandals of the Old Testament. At Christmas, we celebrate the birth of the Savior with skeletons in his ancestral cupboard. There is no scandal too small for the God of our Savior, Jesus Christ. God overcomes the scandal of that is mentioned here, and God overcomes the scandals of our lives. There are 14 generations in all from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the exile in Babylon, 14 from the exile to the Messiah. It can read as 3 times 14. But mathematically, it can also be read as 6 times 7. 7 is God's number. The Bible starts with God creating the heavens and the earth in 7 days. God rests on the 7th day of creation. The Bible ends with 7 churches, 7 seals, 7 trumpets, and 7 bowls in Revelation. The number 7 designates the work and the presence of God. The presence of 2 times 7 equals 14 generations in Matthew 1 denotes that God is involved in the making of this genealogy. Now, with the ending of 3 times 4 generations, or should I say 6 times 7 generations, we now come, okay, because it's 3 times 14 or 6 times 7. So if we take 6 times 7, then we are now arriving at the 7th set of 7 generations. 7 squared, if you like. This 7th set of 7 generations is fulfilled in the birth of Jesus the Messiah. God now moves into human history in his own time. When the time had fully come, God sent his son to be born of a woman. And we look back at the events referred to and recorded in the Old Testament as indicated by these names. And we ask ourselves this question. What if Satan had his way and stopped the flow of the next of kin in the chain? What if Perez was not born to Judah and Tamar? What if Rahab did not help those 2 spies? What if Naomi did not bring Ruth back from Moab? What if Solomon was not born to David and Bathsheba? What if Nebuchadnezzar actually killed all the children of Jehoiakim? And what if Israel evaporated in exile? The God of the number 7 oversees the events of history. And now, this God of the number 7, who oversees the events of history, this God is now coming into the world to be born as a baby in that manger in Bethlehem. And Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, and Mary was the mother of Jesus, who is called the Messiah. Why is Joseph listed only as the husband of Mary and not the father of Jesus? And Matthew is very deliberate when he says this. Joseph, the husband of Mary, and then rather than saying Joseph was the husband, the father of Jesus, as in the foregoing parts of the genealogy, instead he says, and Mary was the mother of Jesus, who is called the Messiah. So why is Joseph listed as only the husband of Mary and not the father of Jesus? And we all know the answer to that question. The real father of Jesus, called the Messiah, is God. We read, and we will read next week, that it is of the Holy Spirit that Mary becomes pregnant. And so, Joseph is not the father of Jesus because God is the father of Jesus. God is now coming into the world through the baby Jesus. And now, in this 7th set of 7 generations, God comes now to make his own ultimate act of overturning the scandals of human history, both past, present, and future. God is coming in the form of a baby who is born in a wooden stable And this wooden stable will lead to a wooden cross. Because the baby is born to die. And now in a moment, we are going to celebrate the wooden cross. We are going to partake of this communion now. And it's only bread and only cup. But remember, it points to a wooden cross. I'm going to call upon Joy to lead us in the prelude song to the communion.